But thank you, Rev. Thanks to your ministry, and thanks to Almighty God, because at the end of this all, God should get all the glory and all the praise. So God is still in the healing business, and I can share my testimony, and I don't stop share this testimony and about this ministry. God bless you all.
Hallelujah.
Have a blessed night.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you so much. This is a breakthrough ministry. This is a testimony that this is fertile ground for sure. When you're connected to this ministry, there's always a testimony. I encourage you to send your testimony. Whether you ch put it in the chat, we will read them, we'll go over them, we'll definitely right. We'll make sure that persons are hearing, but we want to just keep in integrity with the time as well. Because I know that there's a lot of testimony and everybody has a breakthrough. So I just want to just thank you for the testimony that you've shared. I mean, it's amazing. This ministry is not without testimony. Not without testimony. God is just doing a lot of things, and you're connected to the right ministry, and you're going to see breakthrough after breakthrough. Our speaker, Minister Diane Lewis. Introduction, I know it will be read by our Minister Claude Grant Morris. Let me just confirm that Mrs. Claudia Grant Morris is on the line here. Well, great. Perfect. All right. Is Claudia there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, perfect, Claudia. Go ahead. Go ahead, Minister.
Good evening, and welcome. Minister Diane Lewis was born in Kingston, Jamaica in 1975 and has resided in the British Virgin Islands since 1995. She holds a diploma in Christian theology and ministry leadership from the Tower of Faith School of Ministry in the British Virgin Islands, and is a licensed minister with the Church of God of Prophecy. Minister Lewis has served alongside her husband of 22 years, Kenrick Lewis, in various capacities in church ministry, including Faith Ministries Directors for Church of God of Prophecy, Paragon Region, consisting of the ABC Islands, the British Virgin Islands, and the US Virgin Islands. Minister Lewis is a former legal and banking secretary who now manages a travel consultancy she co-owns with her husband. They also operate a food establishment known as the Jamaican Kitchen. They have an adult son, Jordan. Minister Lewis is passionate about the work of the Lord and is an avid teacher of God's word. She shares her testimonies of God's healing power every opportunity she gets. And her prayer tonight is that someone will be healed, delivered, and set free from the bondage of illness. Over to you, Minister Dan Lewis.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. How are you doing? Are you hearing me?
Yes, we
Yes, we
are.
are. Good to see you.
Wonderful, wonderful. It is such a pleasure. By the way, thank you, Sister Claudia. Thank you very much for that introduction. It is such a wonderful pleasure to be able to share with all of the people that the team that Reverend Marie Burbick has, Apostle Marie Burbick Bailey has, all of the ministers, all of the friends and family who are on tonight. I want to greet you, our very able facilitator. Yes. God bless you, sis. And I have something to share tonight, and I will not be holding back. I really hope that. So let me put it in the Jamaican vernacular. I hope my head can take it. Because I've come to find out that there are some topics in the body of Christ that they are taboo. We don't want to talk about them. We say all the time, that this and that is happening, but we say it in hushed tones in the little corners. But I'm here to shout some things on the mountaintop tonight as it relates to being healed, not just from sickness for sickness' sake, but sickness that was brought on by craftiness, by witchcraft. All right? I know sometimes we're a little scared of that word, but when you belong to Christ, nothing should scare you. Nothing should cause you to be fearful, because the Lord has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. And I want you to know, even at the beginning right now, that you're looking at a walking, talking, breathing miracle. I should have been dead. I should have been dead maybe from I was younger, but it became quite evident to me, and I'm jumping right into the testimony because I know time is of the essence. We're all ahead in the BVI. And I know some people maybe already feel like they want to put on their PJs, but hold on. Don't go yet, BVI friends. Don't go just yet. But, you know, in 1996, I think that is where the whole thing started for me, when things started to get serious. Growing up, my mother took care of us, four sisters of us. She later on had a son, so I have a little brother. But we were never sick, if you know what I mean. We weren't sicky. Children's Hospital, you know, Bustamante Children's Hospital never saw us, really, until I got older and I moved to the BVI. And what I'm sharing with you now happened while I'm living in the BVI. And this is not to say that these things don't happen elsewhere, but as I said to you, I'm not holding back tonight, because the Lord has released me to speak and to speak clearly about the experiences that I've had. Now, in 96, I came here 95, but in 1996, I became paralyzed, suddenly paralyzed from my waist down. I couldn't walk. I went to my bed, you know, feeling okay. I had come from church the night before, went to my bed. I remember, went to church Sunday night, came across, I live very close to the church, and got in bed, you know, got up in the middle of the night and fell to the ground. I could not walk. I called out to my mother and she said, "What happened?" And I said, I can't get up. And she said, "Get up. What are you talking about? Get up." And I said, "I can't get up." And she had to help me. I was on my way to the bathroom and she had to help me. And just to make a long story short, from that fall, from that little episode right there, I realized that something was seriously wrong with me, because I now started to see doctors and none of them could diagnose me. I heard our facilitator read, she read a testimony earlier, and the mother was saying that nobody could diagnose at first what was happening. And that is how the enemy works at times. He conceals, he hides what's going on with you so that you cannot get the proper treatment. And let me just say this early, brethren. Let me say this early. There is nothing wrong. Faith is good. We should have faith. And that's what we're talking about tonight. We should have faith to be healed, to be delivered, to be set free. But there is absolutely nothing wrong with going to see a doctor. You go to see a doctor, you get your checkup, you hear that you're all right. You do your exam, you know, you're for ladies, and you feel a lump here, you feel a lump there. And you have to go to the doctor to get it checked out, if it's even for them to confirm what is wrong with you. But in my case, I went and none of them could tell me what was wrong. I became like a lab rat. Y'all know what that means. Everybody was poking and drawing blood and trying to figure out, why was this 21-year-old not able to walk? I was in a wheelchair. I don't know if persons who knew me back then remember when I was sick. You know, I saw some of my friends on earlier, and I'm not sure You know, how many of them knew me then? But I started to lose weight and start to look dry up and terrible. And that's one of the things that I notice happens to me whenever I get sick. I start to lose weight, and I'm not talking about 1 pound, 2 pound. I mean, there was even an instance where I lost about 50 pounds, no exaggeration,
I'm not
over
hearing.
The course of 2 months.
Not hearing.
Well, listen. Well, listen some more. Who is that? Oh, that sounds like PK. Are you hearing now? Are you hearing now? All right, I have to move on because time is against us. So basically, what happened to me in 1996, it was such a frightening experience. I'll be very honest. But I'll tell you something strange. At that time, I was living a life for God. And I just say, you know what, God, if this is it, you know, at age 21, then let it be so, because I was in so much pain. Imagine being numb from your waist down, but you're still feeling pain. The pain was on the inside. I could not explain it, but it's like I was being tormented, could not walk. Well, how did I find out now? Let me, because I have so much to share. Let me just finish up or wrap up on this one. How did I find out that this was not any ordinary sickness? Because remember, friends, some of the things that we experience, not some, all of them, they originate in the spirit realm long before they even manifest in the physical realm. And I'm telling you that it's
I'm not hearing. Do you hear me?
Demons were at war.
Go
oh
ahead.
My goodness.
I'll mute that person. Just go ahead.
Okay. So based on, every time he comes in, you know, it's like it throws me off. But the blood of Jesus, right? But the long and short is, friends, you know, going through that, how did I find out? When I got to Jamaica,
I'm not hearing. Do you hear me?
The BVI, not the doctors.
We're not hearing you.
None of the doctors.
I'm not hearing.
Somebody, could you please monitor that situation for me, please? It's clearly, you know, a distraction. Please, somebody monitor that for me. Clearly a distraction, you know, for the people not to hear what I'm saying, because I've been on this program before and I never heard anything like that. All right. So as I'm saying now, how did I know? I went to Jamaica to seek further medical attention, and being there, you know, my family prayed for me. You know, it was really something. I got prayers left, right, and center, and I'm saying to myself, you know, but Lord, what really happened to me in the BVI? And it's like I developed this feeling, this fear. I'll be very honest. Like, I didn't want to go back. As a matter of fact, I made a decision. I'm not going back. So one afternoon, a family member came to visit. She visited from New York. She came to Jamaica. I was meeting her for the first time. And she said to me, Diane, I need a taxi. I'm trying to get to Ocho Rios, but I don't mind going downtown. And I'm giving you the background because I'm going to show you how the Lord works, how he causes things to come together, how intentional he is. And I called for a taxi. I called the person who would normally take me to the doctor while I'm in Jamaica. By this time now, I'm still not walking strong, but I wasn't as bad as I was, but I wasn't really limping around per se. And I said to her, well, let me call the taxi. And the only one I knew is the guy that normally carries me to the doctors, and call for the guy. He is not available. When I saw who they sent, brethren, when I saw, I took one look at the guy and I said, my God, this person really represents a reputable taxi company. How him look so? How him look so? Him here, like it not cut for months. Him clothes don't look right. Something just don't look right about the young man. And I say, of all the people that they could have sent, a him them send, I'm just telling you, you know, it's like I was almost repulsed by his appearance. And I know, say, I set God, I set me up, you know. The Lord was setting me up. When he came and he picked up my cousin, I don't live in Ocherios. I live in Kingston. And he was supposed to let me and my friend off at a particular place and take her. She said, well, you want to carry me to Ocherios? And they settled the price because he was supposed to carry her downtown. And then she turned to me and she said, why you don't come? Because the taxman is coming back to Kingston tonight. And I said, no. My grandmother would be a little worried because we didn't tell her we're going anywhere. Almost immediately, I heard like a voice said to me, go. Just like that. I turned to my friend. I said, you going? She said, well, if you're going, I'm going. We went. Listen, that young man played some kind of music in I'm care. And I'm like, the music matched the way him look. I'm just being very frank, honest, and open. I said, Lord, what did I expect? You know, it was just a big turn off. Like, why did we come? Why did we come? On the way back, this is when I know God is real. On the way back, just before we got to the Bog Walk Gorge, you all know where that is because I left Jamaica so long and I still remember, right? The same guy who was playing all of this reggae music and, you know, play it loud and rowdy up in the car, and he turned down the music and he said to me, because by now, when my cousin got out, I had to come in the front because him saying, nah, show for nobody, go back to Kingston. So I came in the front and I was sitting beside him. The guy turned on the music and he said to me, before he even said anything to me, he started to worship. He said, hallelujah. Turn on the music, you know. Start to say, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Just like you use a donkey, you can use me. And he now turned to me and he said, young lady, what is your name? Now, to be honest, I was wondering if I should jump out the car or stay, because this now is a little bit too strange for me. This kind of switch thing, suddenly it's too strange. He said to me, I have a message from the Lord for you. And I looked at him in a way like, what could the Lord really tell you to tell me? You know? And when I say it like this, friends, it wasn't pride. I think it was more like shock. Like, what in the world is God doing? Why he would, you know, use this man, where him not look too right, and I'm saying all of this for a purpose, because sometimes our deliverance or our blessing, it not look like how we expect it to look, brethren. All right, it don't look the way somebody come, the Lord send somebody to us to help us, to deliver us, to rescue us, but because the package not look right, we shun them. We pushed them away. But I'm telling you, this here was an appointment for me with destiny, with my future. And he said this to me. He said, you are living in the islands. No, it could be any islands, right? But so good so far. He said, you are living in the islands and you became sick suddenly. And by now, he has my attention, because I'm wondering how this man know this. I don't know him. Okay? And he went on and he said, you are living with your mother and a woman in the same apartment. And he described my mother. He described the woman. And he said, that woman, she's responsible for your sickness. No. I know some of you might say, boy, Sister Diane, that sound heavy, you know. That sound like a major accusation, you know, what we're talking about here. Well, I'll tell you what we're talking about. Listen, he went on to tell me exactly how I became ill. Exactly how I became ill. Those little details I'll leave for now. Because if I say it here now, then, you know, I'll be jumping ahead. Well, long and short of the story, he told me, you're going to go back. And I tell him, this same guy, I say, sir, all of a sudden I sir up the man now, sir, calling him sir, the same disheveled, same man when I look to right, calling him sir. I said, sir, everything you have said so far, you're correct, but that part where you're telling me I'm going back, I am not going back. He said this to me. He said, if anything I've told you tonight is a lie, then you're not going back. But as long as, and I know that God spoke to me to tell you this, you're going back to that place. Because this woman has to see you. Her intention was to kill you, but you're going back. All right, fast forward. I did come back. As a matter of fact, I came back because my mother, she insisted that I come back. And then she was excited to tell me something. And I made an appointment, you know, to speak to her on the telephone. You know, when you have to, you know, have the phone, you have to go to auntie yard, go take phone call, and they call at a certain time. Well, that's what I had to do. And one Sunday she said to me, she said, girl, me have something to tell you. I said, I have something to tell you too. And both of us, they wondering who must talk first. And I spoke first. I told her all that had happened and what the guy told me. And she said, well, I don't me have to tell you. You know, said a woman, they hurt you. I said, how you know? She said, she confessed. She told me that you come to the BVI and you're false in our business, so you have to fix your own. Now, some of you may say, well, what could be so serious? Well, let me explain now. That lady, and this is the part now where every time I remember it, it does something to my spirit, okay? That lady was actually a minister in the church that she attended. She was my mother's friend. And there was something about her life that she was trying to hide. And I'll tell you what it is. She and a gentleman had a relationship. They were not married. And they were posing up in the church like husband and wife. They told everybody they were married. Every single time you go to the altar, and them first come lay hands. And something I said at the house triggered her because she thought I knew and was throwing words at her. I was just reading my Bible. And normally I read within. But that particular day, I remember the day the Lord said, read it and read it out, read it loud. And I'm trying to figure out, well, what's the significance? Well, I did find out what's the significance. The lady was trying to hide her lifestyle and she thought I knew. It wasn't me who know, it's the Holy Spirit who snitched on her, and she became vexed and decided she gonna deal with me. You understand? A minister in the church. Listen, friends, let me tell y'all something. Don't give yourselves any illusions. I'm not sending you back into your church or people on every corner and become distrustful of everybody. But I'm saying, and everybody in a church for the same reason. It's not everybody that is there is there for the same reason. Let me explain something to you. Witchcraft. What is witchcraft? Witchcraft can be described as the invocation of supernatural powers to control people or events. Whatever she did, we lived in an apartment together. She had access to my things, okay? And whatever she did that she later confessed, because remember now, if I had any doubts, she confessed, right? She went, did whatever she did, and then guess what? The worst part, she was feeding me. I was eating this lady food, and one day I said to her, you know, boy, this food tastes good. And she said, you always love my food, man. Just like that. I remember one night in the house, I was feeling so sick. And she came wanting to pray. And instead of the woman pray for me to be healed, you know what she prayed for? She said, I see death. And she started to march around the house saying that she said death, she said death, she said death. So it's like she was doing her word curses. Word curse is an utterance intended to invoke, again, a supernatural power to inflict harm or punishment on someone. Usually it's done in an expression of anger or other strong emotion. Let me tell you something about, you see the Psalms? I'm testifying and I'm teaching at the same time. Some of you already know these things, but as a reminder, you see the Psalms that we have in our Bible, I have my Bible here open to one of them. Be very careful about people who come to you and tell you, read this Psalms and do the Psalms. You have some Psalms that are known as the imprecatory Psalms. And they're the Psalms that David prayed when he felt like his enemies were after him. One such example, and I have it here because everything I'm telling you is biblical. It is Psalm 69. And in verse 14, he said, let me be delivered from them that hate me and out of the deep waters. Then he went on to say in verse 22, let their table become a snare before them. So this is now David literally cursing his enemies. He's asking God to deal with them, to kill them. And I always say, friends, God is not anybody's hitman or personal assassin. When people deal with you these wicked kind of ways, pray for their salvation. Pray for their repentance. Because in doing that, you know what you're doing? You are now passing the situation over to God to deal with it. But these Psalms that we pray and we sing and whatever we do, and we say, it's in the Bible. What is our motive? He went on to say, and that which should have been for their welfare, let it become a trap. Some people walk around literally almost the Bible upon them head, quoting Bible and uttering word curses. They literally use the word. And I know some people find that very strange because they say, but it's not the Bible, it's the word. What is the motive behind it? Who did you upset? Who you trouble? Who you excelled? Who is it that is jealous? And they come after you so that you can be sick and die. The plan was for me to be dead, but it never worked. Years after, I got a job at a law firm. And let me tell you something. Y'all think God easy? No, don't mess with God. The very thing that this woman was trying to hide from the church, hide, is the first file. When I applied for the job at that law firm, they wanted to see if I knew how to put a brief together for the lawyer to take to court. So they took out all the documents and mixed them up and all of that. And I had to put them together in order. Okay, work that I had done before, but they want to know if me know. And whose file was it? That same woman's file with everything was she trying to hide. Open up in front of me. Now, I'm saying, friends, I mean, that day, me could even tell nobody. I just had to be in the file room. I give a little shout unto God. Me say, my God, this is what this lady wanted to kill me for? A minister in the body of Christ? Friends, listen. It's not everybody, I said it already and I'm going to say it again. And everybody come to church for the same reason. And I'm not saying it for you to become suspicious of everybody, but ask the Lord to increase your discernment. What they say, and every smile is a smile, something like that. Be careful. Yes, the Lord calls on us to love and to, you know, be peaceful with one another. But may I tell you, some people don't want a peace with you. They don't. Something about you something about your life. It causes them to become angry. That some are jealous. Some of them feel so well, you know, as this woman say, you're fastening them business and what them are going to fix yours. You know, when the Lord has called you, like he has called me to be a mouthpiece for him, the devil tries to shut up my mouth. But this was not the illness that he did that with. This was to take me out at age 21, but it never worked. Slowly but surely, I started to get the strength back in my legs. I started to walk again. I could run again. A doctor told me that if I walked, you know, after doing all kind of tests on my knee and the reflexes, he said I would walk with a limb. I do not walk with a limb. Glory to God. To God be the glory. And this is just one example of where craftiness, some people don't believe, but until it happens to you, then that's when you kind of understand. There are countless people, and I'm not exaggerated, who have had to, you know, help with these same kind of situations, because first of all, people tell them that the crazy is the head. Nothing goes like that. Listen, friends, and your head, it is for real. Be careful. When the Lord tell you don't eat that, dash it away. When he says to you, don't go there, don't go. When he tell you, no, go back down to the woman they are, don't go down there. The Lord is trying to protect you and to protect purpose that is in your life. You may not see it that way at that time, but the Lord knows exactly what he's doing. Now, if the enemy had his way with me, I wouldn't have even lived to go through the other things that I went through. So that was 1996. All right, fast forward. Stuff happened in between. Okay, you try to kill me. It never happened. Lost a lot of weight. The weight come back. Well, yeah, won't get into that, right? But years after, well, let me just share this before I move on. I came face to face with that lady. After everything started to come back, I came back. She saw me. She nearly dropped down. Because as far as she's concerned, I got Jamaica and I'm not coming back. That's what she told my mother. She's not coming back. She gonna stay down there till she's dead. Can you imagine? She was so angry. That's what she told my mom. My mom had to move away from her urgently. And then where did my mom end up? At a place that my husband's father was in charge of. And that's how I met my husband. So when I tell you that what looks like, you know, something that is difficult and you can't deal with it, the Lord always knows how to turn a mess into a message. Yes, it's cliche, but it's true. He knew that I had to be back in the BVI. And like you heard in my short bio, married now for 22 years. So, all right, let's fast forward 2020 now, COVID year. All right. I developed a brain leak. So it never killed me before. So I'm going to try something else. I developed a brain leak along with a condition called trigeminal neuralgia. Listen, trigeminal neuralgia is known as a suicide disease. For those who were on this platform before, you would have heard me share this. Okay? It is known as a suicide disease because people would rather die than live with the pain. So that is to show you, right? It has been pain for me. And I had to go through all sorts of things. The doctors, the technology, you know, the specialist needed in the BVI to help me was not here. So they had to airlift me to Florida. That's in 2020. With the brain leak, the trigeminal neuralgia, TMJ, severe sinusitis. It's like everything was going on in my head. And literally, this time, I say, yeah, man, you come for kill me again. I could tell. And the Lord said, not so. It's not happening. You understand? And I went through that whole period. I remember being in the hospital in Florida, and for a whole week, they're running tests and doing things. And would you believe that at least 5 specialists come and said to me in the midst of my pain, in the midst of everything, so them don't see anything wrong with me. Here we go again. I was airlifted for nothing, to hear nothing. No, something wrong. Something is wrong. And let me tell you something, friends. You may not hear me quoting a lot of scripture just yet, but I'm telling you, when the Lord is for you, when he has marked your life for purpose, purpose cannot die. And as much as they said that, the Lord used a little Spanish lady. And she said to me, Diane, do not leave the U.S. until they take care of you. And of course, it started a whole process to get new doctors, get new tests done. And guess what? The same problem they identified in the BVI, it was right there. And five specialists said they saw nothing wrong in my head. I remember one of the neurosurgeons, he was said these words to me. He said, you should be happy because your MRI is clean. You have no tumors, you have no this, and he's calling out all the things that can happen in your head. And only to find out I had this brain leak. So they patch it, do what they had to do. Before I know it, I was back in the States again, correcting the trigeminal neuralgia. By the time I got home, I had a hernia surgery. And it's like, you know, the sickness just follow me. I say, oh, what is for me, Jesus? So what me do so? And then, of course, James chapter 5 became my friend. It became my song. The part that talks about, is anyone sick among you? Right? Let him call for the elders and let them pray and anoint with oil, and the prayer of faith shall heal the sick. Some translation says shall save the sick. And I'm telling you, I held on to that. I held on to the fact that the word of God says you will live. Okay? Psalm 118:17. I had some verses that they were like my daily vitamins. And that's the thing, friends. When you're sick and you're going through, make sure that you have positive people around you. People who will speak life. Don't be like this woman marching up and down in front of my boat. I see death. I see death. I see death. That alone should have tell me there's something wrong with this lady. You understand? Just kind of hop back there for a minute. But just to say, the years I saw her, just to back up a bit, I realized I had forgiven her. And that's one of the biggest weapons to healing. When you let go. Let go. I come into that. So here I am now in Florida, about to now get what would be my second brain surgery. So I did one, did another one, and I'm home now. Feeling good, getting better. Life start to feel normal again. This is 2021, 22. Was great. Looking back, I say, yes, this is good. Starting to feel good again. Bam, 3 start. I say, all right, things still look good. Went on a little trip. About 1 week after coming back from that trip, ended up in the emergency room, sick again. I had no idea how sick I was, none. I just knew I had a severe headache. I went to bed on Friday night, woke up Saturday morning with a severe headache. And I'm talking about last year now. So, you know, I'm coming down now. I'm coming down to the close now. Because this one now was the big whammy. This is the one now where it looked as if the doctor had to come and shake the head. But get into that. So I come back. Have this headache. As a matter of fact, I went out like 2 times before. I had a meeting with the Jamaican. The Jamaican Association here is very active. And we were there. You know, they have some new things talking about. I was there. Took some pictures. I look normal. I look okay. All right. Come back from this trip. And that was a Thursday night. Friday night, got to bed. Saturday morning, terrible headache. When I got to the ER, the only thing I remember, it's when somebody asked my husband and my son, they took me, and somebody asked him, is she in pain? And I remember answering to say yes. I also remember a doctor coming out and introducing herself. And I don't remember nothing else from that. Nothing else. Diane passed out, right? Just to find out after that I started to have seizures. When they ran tests, CT scan, MRI, everything, it revealed a swollen brain. I had developed meningitis. Now, for those, I don't know if anybody on the live tonight, if you ever had it or know anybody who had it, some people say it usually affects mainly like younger people, children, and so on. But here was me. I developed that meningitis on the brink of death. I have some friends here tonight. Some, I saw their names. Some work at the same hospital, so they can verify everything I'm saying. Right? I was out. Deep sleep. As a matter of fact, they did what you call a spinal tap, because I realized that I did have a high intracranial pressure, which was pushing, you know, fluid out of my nose. So it's like the leak had come back. And that is why we're talking about when you see these things are reoccurring, something not right. Generational curse, a curse, something. Word curses, the same kind of things that I described earlier. And for about a couple days, well, I was told, because I have no recollection, they did the spinal tap, realized that my intracranial pressure was high, and, you know, did what they could, put me on some medication, and took me to the ward, right, to recover. Sometime thereafter, Diane start to crash. Yep. You know, as you say, everything start go off. And a nurse told me this. She said, Diane, I was the nurse that pack up your stuff to go to the ICU. And I never knew I would see you again. She said, in all of my career, I've seen people come close to death and they bounce back, but you were the closest I ever see come to it and bounce back. Let me tell you something, friends. When your trust and your confidence is in God, there is nothing that the devil can do to kill you before your time. It sounds funny, but it's true. When you have been marked, you have been sealed, and you're covered by God for a purpose, him can't kill you. Throw me into a coma for about 4 days. I don't remember nothing. 4 or 5 days. And I make this joke now with God. I said, Lord, you owe me 5 extra days because them days I'm in a remember nothing. And me need back my days. Right? But I'm saying things were so rough that the doctor had to speak to my family. And basically what my sister was telling me is they were saying, well, they did all they can, and it's just a wait and see thing now, all right? In this ICU, deep sleep, deep coma, while people there waiting for me to wake up, I'm somewhere off. People ask me, did you see Jesus? Who you see? Did you see Moses? I said, no, never see Jesus. I never see Satan. I never see nobody. But you know what happened? I was hearing music. I was hearing some of the sweetest music I had ever heard in my life. Well, I didn't know I was out. So when I came to, I said to my husband, were they playing music in the hospital? He said, music? No. I said, no, man, they were playing music because I heard music. So that now, it says something to me that there are some ways that the Lord would even use to make you well. He can make you well. He's the one that's doing the work. The prayer of faith will save the sick, but the Lord is who doing the saving. All right? So I'm there. The doctor is waiting and seeing. She told me that somebody said to her, what are we doing about Diane? Because they wanted to fly me out again. And she said she heard a voice say to her, don't do anything yet. Wait until, and gave her the day. And that was the day I woke up. Okay? Let me tell you something. I've never seen anything like it. People were coming. It's like news started to spread abroad. Diane, wake up. Diane, wake up. The nurses were coming in by the droves, one by one. They're coming in. Everybody wants to know, what's my name? Do you remember me? You know, all of that. And it was something else. And I didn't understand how sick I was. I was close to death. I had a near-death experience. Listen, it's when I wake up, the powers of darkness start to quiver. I could just hear them. Uh-oh, she's back. Listen, the Lord disappointed the enemy on my behalf. Disappointed, I'm telling you, there were some who were waiting to hear of my demise. But the Lord disappointed them. He said, no, not yet, not now. When I was being discharged from the hospital, the local hospital, because I still had to go away, the voice of the Lord said to me very clearly, he said, they thought they would have lost you. Yes, but I kept you. I kept you because there are some promises yet to be fulfilled in your life. Hallelujah. What an assurance. What an assurance. And I said, Lord, I thank you. Because I do believe with all of my heart, friends, I do believe it with all of my heart that this is it. Because since the Lord brought me back, and I'm going to put it like that, I thank the doctors, I thank the nurses, all of the medical professionals here in the BVI, those in Florida. I had to go away, get that leak sorted out again, right? I still had to go away. But the Lord, he caused my strength to come. And instead of an air ambulance, I could fly commercial. And that's how I got to Florida. Had some challenges there. You know, lady threatening to cancel my surgery the day before surgery. And I said, no, lady, it's not happening so. It's not going down like that. And the Lord turned the thing around. I'm saying, people help me financially. I mean, they were just helping. Help came from everywhere. And when I tell you that, I know that I owe a debt that I can't pay to all the people who helped. I know that God did it. The Lord spoke to them, spoke to their hearts, the doctors, the nurses, the specialists, all of them. And here I am today. And I tell God and I tell the devil, I said, look here, devil, you can't shut me up in this season. Whatever the Lord says to declare, that I shall. No compromise. No foolishness. And of course, you know, hell don't vex about that. All right? I've been hearing the voice of God so clearly. I don't know what happened, friends, in that period, that them 5 days. But the Lord did something to me. He did something. He repaired some stuff. He removed some stuff. He threw out some stuff. Hallelujah. He did something, friends, to me. And no, I must be silent. No, I cannot. I refuse to be silent. I will always worship God. And I'm here to tell you tonight, friends, we're talking about faith for healing. Let me tell you something. If you find yourself sick, and anybody come to suggest any funny business, any monkey business to you, come, we go down the road, go check it out. This not normal. Tell them, no. Say the blood of Jesus. Tell them, go so. Because if the day that you decide that you're not going to trust God for your healing, you're on your own. Let me say it, friends. You're on your own. If you have already sought other help apart from God, repent. He will forgive. Say, Father, forgive me. I didn't know what I was doing. I was desperate. And I just feel the unction tonight that there are people on this Zoom tonight that is your story. But I'm saying, don't feel condemned. The Lord knows what he's doing with your life. Just confess and say, Father, I didn't mean to do it. I never mean to go down there. I never meant to dabble. Is my friend carry me and my family carry me? Then take something for me and say, them will carry it. Listen, friends, do not get involved in anything that the Lord has not ordained for your life. Certain things, it's an abomination. Don't get mixed up in it, because then that's when you know you're a goner. Bye-bye. Okay? Because the Lord, he will not stand for that. So that's one. Secondly, anytime you get that discernment, you know that your sickness is not normal, and you know that craftiness is involved, don't pray for the Lord to kill them. Pray for the Lord to save them, because then now that reflects the condition of your heart. Because if you become bitter and if you become vengeful and vindictive, again, you're on your own. The Lord says, vengeance is mine. I will repay. It would shock you sometimes to know that some of the very same people have to come and say, pray for me. It sounds funny, but I'm telling you, friends, the Lord knows what he's doing with your life. If you're sick, if you're ailing, the doctors don't know what is wrong with you. You're spending all your money. People sending money from abroad to come and help you, and you still cannot get any answer. Listen, go to God and say, Father, reveal the thing. Let me know, is this a curse that came down through my bloodline? Is this something that I didn't have a thing to do with, but it has fallen upon me? Ask the Lord. He will reveal. Because sometimes when you go through, people do ascribe it to sin in your life. Some of them mock you, they scorn you, they look at you and they say, yes, that's something them do. Why the Lord have punished them? I'm saying it to you because it happened to me. They said it about me. They say, yes, of all of the things when she did on Facebook, I talk, the Lord deal with her. When all I'm doing is speaking, thus saith the Lord. Whether they like it or they don't like it. In season, out of season. Sometimes you have to, not sometimes, all the time, friends, you have to make up your mind that for God I live and for God I die. For God I live and for God I will die. Make up your mind. He that loves his life will lose it. If you get to a point where the Lord himself cannot get the glory from your life, and you want to use it and put it there and put it there, make God promises, and you say, Lord, if you heal me, I'm going to do this and do that for you, and he heal you, and like you forget, I'm saying return. Return to the things that you said to God when you were sick. That's for those who were sick. If you're sick now, one of the things that the Lord says to us, if I regard iniquity, Psalm 66, verse 1. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. This is not condemnation. This is not to say that, you know, you have up things in your heart and that's why you're sick. No, because people will say that. But once you know that your heart, the seat of your heart, it is clear, it is pure, it is clean, clean hands. You don't have a thing to worry about. Go before God and watch him lift you out of that situation. And the same demons and the imps around will see. Talk about the Lord setting a table for you in the presence of your enemies. If you really want to see God work on your behalf, do what he says and do it how he says to do it, and he will take care of you. All right? Trust God. From the moment man was born and Adam sinned, that original sin, we started to die. But the Lord, in all of his goodness and his mercy, he has mercy. And look at Hezekiah. Look at the story of Hezekiah. When the Lord sent the prophet to him and said, set your house in order, Hezekiah. You are going to die. And Hezekiah prayed. He turned his face to the wall. And he said, Lord, remember me for the good that I did. And the Lord sent back the prophet and said, go back. I've seen his tears. I've heard his prayer. Tell him I will add 15 more years to his life. And I'm sure that's what the Lord did. So friends, your situation is not too far. It doesn't matter what it is. If it's cancer, it's just a name, and it will have to bow to the name of Jesus. If it is diabetes or look like it's getting out of control, then I promise to cut off your foot and your toe and whatever. The Lord can touch you tonight. He can heal you from that. High blood pressure, some of these things that happen in our bodies, it is not our portion. Yes, some of them are lifestyle diseases. So we have to watch that. We have to use wisdom. If the doctor say your pressure high, come off of the salt. Don't go eat the whole heap of salt. And when they get sick, you run, come to church and say, you know, pray for me, please, my pressure high. And you know, you just don't eat the whole heap of salt biscuit and the pigtail and, yeah, like but some of us do. I'm just saying, friends, I'm just saying to you tonight, the Lord can fix your situation. Nothing is too hard for him. Absolutely nothing. I remember one time, and I shared this with Reverend Marie. It was like there was just this anointing on my life. I'll be very honest. For people with knee problems. Knee. It's like everybody who came into my presence. We were talking about whatever. And all of a sudden, boy, my knee hurt me. Pray for that one. Anoint them with oil. They go check on them a couple days or so after. Why not too bad, you know? You understand? When they look again, one more come again. Lord, Sister Diane, my knee. I'm like, Lord Jesus, what is this? I'm just saying, friends, that it doesn't matter what the ailment is. The Lord can heal you. And I know he's going to heal some people tonight. He's going to heal some of you tonight because your faith now has arisen to the level after hearing how good God is. This is not about me, friends. It's about the goodness of God and his ability to heal. So what we say we're going to do now? We say we're going to trust God. We're going to make sure that our heart is clean. It is a place now where the Holy Spirit can come in and do our work. All right? You and then, of course, after the Lord has healed you, you have to know how to maintain your deliverance so you don't go back into the bad practices that you probably used to have. You maintain, you know, in God, you pray, you know, you fast, you do your spiritual disciplines so that you can stay healthy in God and he can use you. If you're sick, the Lord can use it to do what? And he knows that. And that is why he heals, he delivers, he sets free. And that is what is available for you tonight, friends. I'm speaking this because I'm absolutely convinced of it. When I see, you know, some people would probably say, as we say in the Jamaican vernacular, puss and dog now have the same luck because people pray and the people are still dead. And, you know, we have heard that, but listen, if it's one thing I know about God, he's sovereign. God is sovereign. He knows exactly what he's doing, and he knows how to turn every negative situation that the enemy meant for evil. He knows how to turn it around for all good. Read the word, take up the word and read it. Now bother with the imprecatory psalms and start praying on fire upon the enemy. And, you know, I'm not talking about demons, because an enemy of God is an enemy for us. But I'm saying sometimes the motives, let it be that our motives are right. If everybody were to pray the eye for eye and tooth for tooth, everybody would be blind. I have a friend, I don't know if she's on tonight, Marissa. You know, she said, can you imagine being in a church and everybody blind? Why? Because people kept praying against one another. That's not what the Lord wants us to do. Vengeance is his. And it's important for me to tie that in to healing, because sometimes it's not just about coming to God and praying and say, Lord, heal me. It's also about how we view our situation. Are we angry, resentful, unforgiving, hateful because of what them do me? You know, this lady, I could have up that lady for life, but that is not God's way. It's not God's way. And I don't sit one side and wait and pray that, you know, I hear bad news about her. I pray that she repent. Repent and turn away from evil and them kind of something there and come up in a church. I'm not going back there. I've said all of that already. I'm just simply saying, friends, that the Lord can heal you. He has the ability, nothing too hard for him. Okay, so I really want to pray. Reverend Berbick, moderator, is it okay just to pray now for those who are ill?
Yes.
Those who are
go ahead, minister.
Right, it's so important, because what you have here tonight, I'm not sure, let me see. Right, you have a quite a number of persons here tonight, and every single one of the people are on this line now. Every single one of you. You have purpose inside of you, and that's what the devil is after. If he can kill you before you fulfill purpose, oh, he would rejoice. But I'm saying to you tonight, we're going to pray, and we're going to ask the Lord. We're going to petition God and say, Lord, no, this is not the season. This is not dying season. This is living season. And my prayer over each of you is that the Lord would cause you to live, not just exist, but you would live in your purpose, walk in your purpose. You'd forget fear. Fear is stifling some people right now. Fear. Some people are sick and they don't want nobody to know. They haven't told their family. They haven't told their friends. My God. I'm definitely feeling that anointing. You know, people are suffering silently. They don't want to worry anybody. But I'm saying to you tonight, friends, just as you think not telling them, you know, is not going to bring them worry, the Lord can take care of that. And hear what? It's only afterwards you're going to tell them now, say, boy, you know, say that and that did happen. And they would never believe. But when you show them the tests and you show them the results, the stuff that you are hiding up, then that's when their faith arise now for what they need from God. So I'm going to pray now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus. Lord, tonight I just want to lift up your name. I want to magnify your name, oh God, because of who you are. Lord, I've proven you. I've proven, oh God, that you are the life giver. And when the enemy comes in to kill, steal, that you came to give life and life more abundantly. Lord, you said in your word that I shall live, your people shall live, to declare your works, O God, to declare what you have done for them. And tonight, Father, every single person that is here on this line tonight, I pray, God, that you would move into their lives in a very special way, that, Lord, you would move even into their bodies and everything that is out of alignment, mighty God, you would put it back into alignment. Every part, Lord, that is not working, that you would cause them, oh God, to receive even new parts. Because, Lord, you are the God of the supernatural. You're the God of miracles. Lord, we're tired of chasing after miracles. We want to be the miracle. We want to be the one to testify and say that I'm a living, breathing, walking miracle because of what you have done in their lives, oh God. Lord, I pray right now for those who are they got a report of cancer. Lord, cancer is just a name. And at the name of Jesus, that name will bow in the name of Jesus. Cancer, you have no power over God's people. You will not take them out. They shall live and not die. It doesn't matter what stage it's at. You will not win, adversary. In the name of Jesus, they shall live. They shall live. They shall live. This is not false hope. They shall live. They shall live because faith shall arise and they will believe that you're able, oh God. And I thank you tonight because you're gonna do it. Do it for their good, oh God, and do it for your glory, mighty God. I thank you tonight, Father. Lord, you brought me back from the jaws of death. You brought me back, oh God, from the edge. You rolled back the curtains, oh God, and you put me all the way back from the edge of what the enemy wanted to do to my life. He came to destroy my life because he had tried to steal it. He didn't get through. He tried to kill me. He did not get through. So he came to destroy it. But Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray a covering over your people now, God. Let there be no backlash. Let there be nothing, no revenge, nothing that he comes with, oh God. Let the fiery darts and the arrows that he's sending even now, God, backfire in the name of Jesus. Backfire in the name of Jesus. And they will not land. They will not land on your people, mighty God. Lord, they will receive their deliverance tonight in this self-same hour in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray right now that your power will move into their bodies and let them feel it like fire shut up in their bones, oh God. Let them feel the warmth. Let them feel the fire resting on their head and moving through their body, oh God, straight down to the soles of their feet as you perform surgery. In the name of Jesus, as you cure, as you heal, as you deliver, as you pull out what doesn't belong, anything, oh God, that has been lodged there, mighty God, by the enemy, I pray, oh God, that you would pull it out in the name of Jesus, that you would remove it in the name of Jesus, that, Lord, they will live to testify of your goodness. They will live to testify of your great name. They will raise up, oh God, out of their bed of affliction. And they will live. They shall live. They shall live. I speak life in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, mighty God. I know that you're doing a work, God. Even in the simplicity of this prayer, I know, Father, that you're moving. You're moving, Lord. Even when we can't see it, you're moving. My God, 5 days silence from me, oh God. Nothing seemed to have been going on. But Lord, all along, you were healing me. You were restoring me. And I know, oh God, that you're doing that tonight to your people. Every single one of them will experience your healing, oh God. Will experience you in a brand new way. And Lord, I even pray for those who may have gone and sought help from other sources, mighty God. I pray that you would bring forgiveness, Lord. Forgive them, oh God, because they did not know what they were doing. Mighty God, I thank you now, Father, that they would just release all of that to you so that you can heal them. Oh Lord, man may not know, but you know all things. And Lord, I pray tonight, I intercede on their behalf, oh God. I intercede on their behalf that your anger would not be kindled against them. But Lord, you will forgive. You will forgive just as Moses interceded for the children of Israel. Oh God, when they worshiped that golden image, that calf, oh God, and angered you to the point where you felt like destroying them. Lord, I pray right now that you would have mercy. That you would have mercy, oh God, mercy on your people, mercy on those who are not saved, mercy on those, oh God, who are even at the brink of giving up. Mighty God, you can do it. Hallelujah. Do it, God. Do it, mighty God. Do it. Do it, God. I know that you're working in somebody's body right now. You're working in somebody's body right now, mighty God. I see the tools that you're using to perform holy and divine surgery on them. Lord, you're changing the doctor's report. They go back. The doctors will be baffled. They will say, what happened to your condition? Look at this. This is what you came with last time. And this is how your results look now. What did you do? Whatever you're doing, keep on doing it. Lord, I just thank you now for a changed report. Lord, continue to baffle the doctors. They have a purpose, God. You have set them up to help us. But Lord, I pray that you would even cause them to declare your works based on what they're seeing. Lord, even in my case, it happened. Lord, I thank you that you're not a respecter of persons. And Lord, you're going to do it for them. You did it for me, and you will do it for them. Mighty God, I thank you now, Father. I bless your holy name, because I know, oh God, that a shift is here. A shift has come. Something has changed. A burden has been lifted in the name of Jesus. Those who are walking around with shame, oh God, because of their condition, I know, oh God, that you have changed their report. You have changed it, oh God. And now they will be able to hold their head up in confidence in you, God, because of what you did. Now they can speak. Now they can testify because you did it. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, mighty God. Help your people, Father. Help them, oh God. The one that is crying, even now, crying and saying, Father, you know what I need. I pray, oh God, that you would minister to them. Somebody who's suffering from a broken heart. Lord, sometimes the illnesses, they're not the physical ones on the outside that everybody can see, but it's the scars that are on the inside. And Lord, I pray right now that you would let your Holy Spirit penetrate, oh God, and go through and heal broken hearts, heal hurts, oh God, that is causing some to be sick physically. Lord, I thank you because you know all things. You're the great revealer of secrets. And Lord, those who believe that it is hidden, it is not hidden from you. My God, hallelujah. Thank you, God. Lord, let your anointing flow even through the airwaves tonight, regardless of where your people are, wherever they have checked in from. Oh, Lord, I pray that you would bless their lives, cause them to rise up in the name of Jesus. They are part of the remnant. Oh Lord, they will fight, they will stand, and they will not be afraid because, Lord, you have proven to them that you're on their side. Lord, I thank you. Thank you for this ministry. oh God, that you have raised up for such a time as this. Lord, I thank you for Reverend Marie Burbick and her team, her husband first and foremost, oh God. Lord, I thank you for the team that you have given unto her, oh God. Lord, she has not shared anything with me, oh God, but I know that you have weeded out some situations, weed out some people so that she can prosper, so that she can walk according to your purpose, oh God. Some were purpose killers, mighty God. Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you for what you're doing through this ministry. Let the testimonies continue to come forward, oh God, so that she would know that her labor of love is not in vain. Bless the ministry, oh God, abundantly, financially, so that they can continue the work of your kingdom, mighty God. I thank you now, God, because I know that you're doing a work even with this ministry, causing it to grow and to explode, oh God, in such a way that it will have the devil confused. He will be baffled because of all that he did to stop this ministry, to stop this woman of God from moving forward. Lord, I pray for restoration in her ministry. Every area, everything that the palmer worm and the canker worm has eaten, I pray, God, that they can have it and you will restore unto her the joy of her salvation. My God, I thank you tonight. Thank you, God. I bless your name because I know, God, that many will have testimonies of your goodness, testimonies of healing, testimonies of deliverance, testimonies, oh God, where they can't even explain it. Some would just be able to cry, they can't explain it. But I know you did a work tonight. And I just want to give you thanks. Lord, cover us, all of us. Surround us with a fiery edge of protection, oh God, where the enemy cannot penetrate, Lord, so that we can pray and we can thank you. And we will have room to just process what we have heard tonight and what has happened tonight. I thank you now, God. Cover us under your blood. Cover us, God. Shield us. Be our shield and our buckler. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you,
hallelujah.
God. Thank you,
hallelujah.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Blessed be your Father.
Jesus. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Minister, we just want to bless you now for that word that you have given us. You say it is impossible to please God without faith, and the very substance and testimony that you have just shared with us, we have revived even within my own soul that there is a something bubbling up. You know, it was just, you know, I feel it deep down that, you know, we need to make another leap, a step. So I really thank you for sharing, and God has released you to speak. And I just want to thank you, and just God pray coverage over you.
Yes.
You know, your word said one shall chase 1,000,
yes.
Two shall put 10,000 to shame. And yes, we come in full agreement for whatever you have interceded on our behalf and released unto us. We are so very grateful for that. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.
Amen.
And God keep you.
Amen.
I just want to say, good night to everyone. Maybe possibly there are some persons who are just joining us now. I am Marcia Scurvin, and we are here talking about healing and faith, right? Very powerful. But I want to just take a moment to acknowledge all the ministers, the apostles, the pastor on the Zoom right now. Every one of you, please accept my greetings. I should have greeted you earlier, but I do greet you in the mighty name of Jesus. So all the apostles, ministers, pastors, everyone that is on now, please accept my greetings. I just want to move on to, well, Welcome to my, oh yes, greetings, Apostle Frederica Burbick as well. And also there is a Pastor Maureen Nabanda that is here. So again, blessings to you all. I want to take a quick testimony from Trudy. Trudy has, you know, a burning testimony. And I really want her to come forward and say that testimony. Trudy, are you here? Yes, Trudy, is Trudy still
Hello?
Here?
Yes, are you hearing me?
Yes, go ahead, Trudy.
Yes, good night, everybody. My name is Trudy and Smith, and I've been following Rev Ministry for quite some time, all right? And I want to share two things about healing, right? When I first came across Rev Ministry, it was on Facebook, a Facebook Live. It was Saturday morning. And she was calling, said, if anybody have anything or anyone to pray about, she's going to take some names for prayer. And I put up Baby Faith. No, Baby Faith was my goddaughter, right? And I put her up on it. And she was born with congenital heart defect. And based on how bad it was, they decided not. She was born at Victoria Jubilee Hospital. They decided not to take her to children because it didn't make any sense. Anyway, she picked up on the name and she said what was wrong with her. I type in, but the words didn't come together, but she recognized what I was trying to say. And she prayed for her. But in my mind, you know, I said to myself, is another prophet for prophet, right? Because I didn't believe and said too much false prophet on Facebook, man. And the Tuesday, that was the Saturday, the Tuesday I got a call from the grandma. So the hospital called the mother to come up to the hospital to take home the baby. She said she's not going to take home the baby because they're sending the baby home today. It so happened that when they went and did the check, nothing. They couldn't see anything wrong with the baby. So they sent home the baby, right? She came home, they put her like 6 weeks, 6 months, whatever, right? She eventually passed on, but it wasn't from congenital heart defect. It was inconclusive. They didn't know what actually killed her, but she got her healing from that, and that was what Rev prayer about. Now, coming on to my baby, I had a baby recently. She's right here, right? And when she was 6 weeks, well, she got the shot the day before the repositioning conference. I was determined to go to the conference. Whatever it is, I was going to go. So when you know that when children get their immunization, they actually get sick, like fever and so on, miserable. And I leave from Montego Bay in the morning. A matter of fact, she was born at a private hospital, so she wasn't given one of the shots other babies would have gotten when she was born. So at 6 weeks, I got that shot. So she got three shots. She had the fever. She was going like this. And I was determined to go to the conference. When I went in Kingston, problem. Couldn't get through to anybody. I stopped in Portmore. And after I stopped in Portmore, when I finally got through to one of the persons assisting Rev, and they told me where I come, I went there. They were on the finishing lap when I reached there. And I spoke to Rev and she said, go get your family. I took the baby in and she blessed the baby for me. And when I took her in, she blessed my family. She was a bottle of olive oil. And when I moved off with the baby, she called me back and she prayed. And she said she's coming against afflictions. And she was like, and she prayed again. She prayed for her. And I was like, okay. But one thing I didn't tell Rev, even though she knew that she was going to get the joke, I didn't tell Rev that the baby have an hernia, big hernia. Right? When I took her to the clinic, they said they can't do anything now. We'd have to wait until she's about 5 before they'll touch it unless it's an emergency. But when they pushed down the finger could go down in the belly. And I took her to the doctor and them said, watch it and whatever. When she prayed and gave me the olive oil, when I went home, I bathed her little by little. I put the olive oil in the water and I bathed her, wash her hair and so forth. One man I was looking about her. And the neighbor beginner come up, puff out, I can see like the like it's not smooth. You can see some lumpy something come up on it. And the spirit said to me, say, Rev, give her the olive oil. Why don't you rub it on it? You should rub it on it for 7 days and pray. And people, I took a picture because I said to myself, I don't want, when I give the testimony, people believe, say, I lie in my hotel. And I took the picture. I remember taking her to a dinner. When I took her, one of the caregivers at the school, is a parent dinner, was looking about her. And she said to me, say, what do I need? At first, me, I saw one so big. And Mr. Den said, she have earned an answer. And me does. I was a bit embarrassed, to be honest, because it was big and I had to buy a larger size pampas, try to cover it, try to hold it down. And on the 7 days after I rub it, I just leave it there. Rub it, pray 7 days. And I kid you not, people of God, that navel, that hernia, you can't push your finger, there's no hole anymore. She's 4 months and 2 weeks, right? So that's about 2 months ago. And the navel gone right down, no hernia, not there. And I'm God, only God and healing, because I believe that it does heal, and I believe that the prayer that Rev prayed for the affliction of my child without she even knowing that something was wrong with her, because I didn't disclose it. So I can tell you that God is real, and he will do what he says he will do. And I can tell you too that Rev Marie have the gift. She have that gift, tried and proven time and time again. I can't tell anybody anywhere. Tried and proven. God is working through her. The anointing of God is upon this lady and her ministry. I can tell you, because I was the first doubtful Jenny. I can tell anybody that when I first came across my exact words and thought, another prophet for prophet. Because we all know in the space of social media now, you have these people coming, they come in the name of God and just money, money, money. Right? It's the first ministry I ever feel to put out. It's the first, and it's the first person, the only person I really follow. When anything happened to me, I can say, pray. I can call Rev and say, Rev, I send a message, I'm asking you to pray for me. Even the other day, I put a message and said, last Zoom meeting I was on, and I was inspired by the testimony. And just as I put it up, she sent me a prayer about 3 minutes after to pray for me. And I was in a bad place. I was in a bad, bad, bad place. Let me tell you, a bad place, I think things I'm not supposed to think. And it was her prayer that is having me in this calmness now. Because sometimes people hurt you. And you are really, as the lady said before, you become vengeful, you have thoughts to do things that is not godly. So I can tell anybody, believe, because God is good and God hear and God answer. And there are, persons who stand in gap for you. And Rev Marie, if she tell you, I can't tell anybody, if she tell us, say, go and go pray. Have faith. Because it will, and God will see you through. Can't tell anybody that.
Amen.
Can't tell anybody.
Amen, sister. Amen. Thank you. I thank you, God, for that powerful testimony. Really thank you for that. These are the testimony that encourages us and lift our faith even stronger. You know, I want to take, Rev, with your permission, I want to take Mary Bailey's testimony as well. Yes. Mary, are you still there that you want to go ahead with that testimony?
Yes.
Yes, go ahead.
On the 2nd day of February, I went to school, and as I was there, my co-teacher said to me, how come you're talking so funny? And one of my students said, Miss Bailey, your words are slurring. And I didn't realize it, but they said it. And then when I started to walk, I started to sway. And Deborah, my co-teacher, reached out and grabbed me and said, sit down. And I sat down. At the end of the day, I was just rushing to catch a train because I teach in New York. I was rushing to catch a train. And she said, no, I'm taking you home. I said, you live right up there. You're going to drive all the way to Jersey? She said, yes, I'm taking you home. She took me home. And normally when I come home, I would wash out my tea mug first thing. I didn't do that. I just went straight to bed. In the morning when I woke up, I couldn't lift my legs. I couldn't lift my arms. I could barely talk. I called my daughter and she wasn't answering. And then I left a message, a voice message. I said, Nikki, my speech is slurred and I can't move my legs. So I'm going to call 911 and go to St. Joseph's Hospital. And that's what I did. And when I got there, I the only thing I remember them asking me was, what is your name? They said I was able to answer that, but I wasn't able to say what year it was, who was the president of the United States. None of that I wasn't able to answer. And then I passed out. And the thing that hurts me the most was when my daughter came in and my son-in-law, I did not recognize them. And when my daughter realized that I didn't recognize her, she started to cry. And I think they might have gone downstairs for tea. And then the doctor phoned her and said, you need to come back now to sign this paper so that we can intubate her, because she just had a massive, massive seizure. And my daughter ran back upstairs and said, yes, I'll sign it. And she signed whatever. And I passed out. And for the next 8 days, I was in ICU. Now, my daughter is a very private person, but she knows my friends and she reached out to them. The first person she reached out to is my girlfriend at the Gleaner, Erica Virtue, my former co-worker. And Erica put a prayer on Facebook. And believe you me, my phone, once I came back to, my phone was ringing off the hook and people were praying, left, right, and center. And they started to give me anti-seizure medication. They did a spinal tap just to find out what was going on with my brain. Turns out, well, they say that because my dialysis period is shortened during the week, that is causing a problem, and that is what is causing me to have the seizure. But all I know is that I went to a very, 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 very serious, serious place, and I did not think I would ever return, and neither did the doctors. They didn't think I would ever return, because when I woke up and was smiling and chatting, they said, oh my God, you're a different person. And when I woke up in the morning, my hands were tied up. So I don't know why, and I didn't ask because I was embarrassed. But all I know is that I was restrained. And was in the hospital until the 20th, until they were satisfied that I could walk, and they released me into the care of my daughter. So now I'm with my daughter in West Orange. And I just have to thank God. I just have to thank God. I just have to thank all my friends. Everybody. I have no words, because I know that prayer did it. Prayer did it. And when I go back on my Facebook page and I see the number of prayers that went up for me, I know in my heart that prayer did it, because I was in a dark place. And I have faith. I have faith. My faith has grown so strong. My faith has been activated because nobody expected me to come back. I was in such a dark place that I did not even feel the intubation. You know how when they push that thing down your through your nostrils and down your throat? I didn't feel that. And so I know how badly my condition was. And now I know that God is real because he took care of me. And he said it was not yet my time. And I'm so grateful for everybody who said a prayer for me. I'm so grateful. And that is my testimony.
Thank you so much for sharing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's just open our mic just for a few seconds and just glorify God in what he's doing. Jesus. Just let us glorify and lift him.
Hallelujah.
He's an amazing God. He's the lion, the tribe of Jesus. Thank you so much. Akila, put up that flyer for me with the donation flyer. Father God, we thank you now, mighty God. Thank you, God, for what you're doing. It's a powerful, powerful, powerful testimony. Powerful testimony. We just thank them for sharing, because sometimes we keep our testimony to ourselves, you know, and we don't share it to release somebody else in their growth. So, you know, we just want to give them all the thanks, you know, and everything. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God. Lord, and if you have faith like a mustard seed, you should tell your mountain to move on that mountain. Move. Hallelujah. Anybody want to move some mountain tonight? Anybody want to move any mountain tonight? Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Thank you, God. We give you all the glory. Mighty God. We give you all the praise for it. Cover this ministry. Cover the woman of God. Continue to lift them up in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The information, ways to partner, if you want to partner with this ministry, the information is on the screen. You know, there is Cash App, there is the Zelle, and there, of course, for persons who are in Jamaica, the Scotia account, Mandeville check-in. Under Marie Burbick 652697, right? And the PayPal at Rev Marie Burbick, and there's a Cash App and the Zelle. All right. So there are many ways that you can partner with this ministry so that we can continue to do the work that, you know, is set above for to be done. Right. So continue. We are grateful for your support, and we want to just extend those information so you can partner. Thank you so much. And it's also in the chat. Before we move on, I want to, before we put the scripture on the screen, I want to take this time to bring on my apostle Marie Burbick. I know we are at 10:33, so I'm cognizant that there are time that we want to remain, you know, within the time span. But I want to just bring our apostle on at this time. Apostle Marie Burbick, go ahead. Okay. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Sister Marcia, for hosting tonight. We appreciate you so much. And thank you to the members of the team for your hard work. Thank you, Minister Dan. My God, every time I hear the testimony, it still sounds fresh because there is just so much power in that testimony. And so many lives are being changed and transformed each time you share. So continue to share. The Bible says we overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So we are thankful that tonight God has used you to again be a blessing to the people of God by sharing that testimony. And I'm telling you, you basically covered us tonight. So I'm not going to hold up the people of God, because sometimes when you are ministering, you can feel when the atmosphere shifts. And you know when the Holy Spirit is at work and you move accordingly. So what I wanted to share on tonight about manifesting the healing grace, I will leave that for perhaps next week. What I will do tonight, as the Lord has led me to do, is to pray, you know, special healing prayers for the people of God who are here tonight. This is what the Spirit of God is leading me to do. I want to thank those of you who shared your testimony, Sister Trudy, Sister Mary, Sister Rileen. I hope I'm not forgetting anyone who shared a testimony tonight. I want to thank you so much for coming out and just encouraging the people of God with your testimonies. And I want to thank all of you tonight who are partnering with the ministry in any way, shape, or form, whether it is just to participate in the services, or if you are one of the persons who partner with us financially, we just want to thank you. We pray over your seeds, your donations, that your cupboards will never be empty. May the Lord pour back into you many times over what you pour into the ministry to enable us to do what we do and to reach people across the world. All right. So before I pray tonight, I don't know if Akilia has the flyer for the women's retreat. I have to remind you guys, some persons have already signed up. We're having a women's retreat, healing retreat, May 17 to 19, upstate New York. We're going somewhere up in Catskills or so. And it's going to be a time of real refreshing. It's going to be a time of prayer. It's going to be a time of deliverance. It's going to be a time definitely of healing. We will have certain activities that are designed to help women to recover mentally, emotionally, spiritually. It's going to be a rich experience over the two nights, Friday, Saturday, and then we come back Sunday. Yes. And the cost is $350. It covers the accommodation. It covers the meals. It covers everything. And I can tell you from now, in terms of the persons who will be a part of this retreat to facilitate, I'm going to be facilitating. Some of you may not know, but I'm a certified master life coach, a happiness coach. Yes, there's such thing as a happiness coach and a goal success coach. A lot of us need happiness in our lives. So when you come, we'll be pouring into you to show you how to be happy again, because many of you are not happy and you have not been happy for a very long time. So I am one of the facilitators for the healing retreat. We'll also have Lorraine Smith. She is a licensed therapist and a mental health counselor. She will also be one of the facilitators. And we're also going to have Jerome Morgan. Yes, we have a man in the midst who will be coming to pour into us as well. And he'll be going through some wellness and physical stuff and some self-defense thing with us women. Then there is Sister Kerensha. Kerensha is a relationship coach. So all of you with the relationship issues, Sister Kerensha will be there on hand to be a blessing to you. And Dr. Maloney Hunter, some of you would have been, able to meet her at the Reposition Conference. She has a powerful, powerful testimony. And she will be coming as well to share how she recovered, because she has been through so much trauma in her life. But God has helped her to recover and restore, and he has renewed her. And there's no bitterness in her heart despite all that happened. So I'm sure a lot of you need to know how she did this. And all of that we'll be sharing with you during that retreat. So if you're interested, please let us know. If you pay a deposit, maybe 50% by the 1st of March, you will receive a $30 discount. So you'll just pay $320 instead of $350. All right, so you can use the same information that was placed on the screen for the Zelle, the Cash App, the PayPal to send in your payment, and we will register you and send you a receipt. But please make sure you register quickly because it's not going to be a huge retreat, this first one. We are planning it this way because we want persons to get specialized attention. All right, so if you need further information, you know the number for the ministry, 516-601-4175. You can WhatsApp us or you can email. All right. And we will answer your questions and help you to get registered for the healing retreat. So that's May 17, the Friday, through to May 19, the Sunday. Okay. God bless you. All right. So there are persons here who had put some requests on the in the chat. I see there was a lady here who was asking for prayer for her son. No, Sister Chavane, the retreat will not be on Zoom. No, a retreat is private because we're going to be talking to people about deep-seated things that God wants to heal them from. So that's not something we'll be putting on Zoom. All right? So you got to be there in person. I think it's you, Sister Chavane, who was asking for prayer for your son. Is it you? There was somebody who was asking for prayer, said something like the baby is not speaking. There is a speech delay issue. I've just taken a note, so I'll be praying. All right. And I think there was another lady who had asked, just retype the request that you sent in the prayer, in the chat, and I will just lift you up. Sister Vivian is asking for prayer for her daughter, and Camille, prayer for a problem on my job. All right. So I'll be praying for you guys. Please stay with us as the Spirit of God moves tonight. Akilia, go ahead and do the song, and I'm going to come right back and I'll pray, Sister Marcia. So this is how we're flowing as the Spirit of God leads tonight. All right. Okay, I see the requests. I am seeing them. I see Sister Yamina. Okay. Prayer for my feet. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Prayer for my knees. I don't know if it's just from my end, but I'm not hearing the sound at all, Akilia. Hallelujah. We thank you, Spirit.
Hearing it.
Yes. All right, so it's glitching. I saw darkness run for cover. My praise. You've got glory tonight. Anybody come ready to testify of the Lord's goodness? Let's go then. All right, Akilia, I'm just gonna go ahead and pray. If it's a problem, we're having some technical issues, it's okay. I'm just gonna go ahead and pray for the people of God so we can wrap up tonight. Amen. Thank you, Holy Spirit of the Living God. All right, so I'm seeing the prayer requests that are here in the chat. even if I don't call your name, please, I want you to just come into agreement with me tonight. As the Spirit of God moves, just come into agreement if you want the Lord to touch you tonight and to just move over your situation. Whatever you are asking of him, he has heard you. He sees and he knows all. So just believe and trust the Lord tonight that indeed God has done it for you. He has already done it for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit of the living God. I want everybody to just set your hearts in a place now to receive from the Holy Spirit as we prepare to wrap up. Amen. Nobody can steal my joy. Thank you, Holy Spirit of the living God. We just want to thank you tonight, Father, that you have brought us together in this place. In this place, you have brought us together, Father, and we just want to thank you. Like the woman with the issue of blood, we stretch our faith tonight. Come on. I want the people of God to just lift up your hands and come into agreement tonight as I pray. Hallelujah. As I cover you tonight, lift your hands in faith and come into agreement. We are touching and agreeing tonight over all the prayer requests that you would have placed in this chat. And those that you have not placed there, those that remain in your heart, God sees and he knows. So tonight we are coming together. And like the woman with the issue of blood, we stretch our faith to receive healing from the Spirit of the living God. I speak to mountains tonight, mountains of sicknesses affecting you, mountains of sicknesses affecting your families. We speak tonight to the sicknesses in your family, in the bloodline. The Bible says, Father God, that you will restore unto us health and you will heal our wounds. So tonight, by faith, we come into agreement with Jeremiah 30 and verse 17 that you are restoring our health and you are healing our wounds, Father, in the name of Jesus. Psalm 6 and verse 2 says, be gracious to us, O Lord, for we are languishing. Heal us, O Lord, for our bones are troubled. Loose the blood tonight over every person who is here on this Zoom, who is believing you, God, for healing, who has a sickness that has not been healed. Father, we ask right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that you begin to touch hearts, begin to touch lungs. Come on, people of God, wherever you are having the issue tonight, as I speak, just touch the area. I ask in the name of Jesus, Father, that you give us one touch tonight for hearts, one touch tonight for lungs, just a touch we need, God, for kidneys, one touch for pancreas, for the stomach, for throats, Father God, for heads, for hands, for the back, for feet, any area of our bodies that the enemy has touched with infirmities. Tonight we use our hands as a point of contact. We stand in our authority according to your word. There is death and life in the power of our tongues. So tonight, God, our tongues speak life. Our tongues speak healing over our bodies. We ask that you realign everything in our bodies, God, that has malfunctioned. Recalibrate blood vessels, nerves, recalibrate tissues, recalibrate cells. Heal every physiological issue that is affecting your daughters and your sons tonight, God. Father, according to Psalm 103 and verse 3, it says that you forgive our iniquity and you heal our illness. So tonight we come before you in humbleness, humility, mighty God, and we ask for your forgiveness of all our iniquities. We ask that you will heal our diseases. Father, everything we have been holding up in our hearts against other persons which have been blocking our healing, tonight we release them in the name of Jesus Christ, regardless of who it is, God, that has hurt us. Tonight we are releasing them so that the blessing can come. We're releasing them so that your healing can come in the name of Jesus. Father, I stand in the gap tonight as an intercessor for the people of God. I repent for the sins of those who have sinned and have not even realized it. As I utter these words tonight, God, from a sincere heart, we ask that you move with mercy. We ask
ask that you restore, renew, replenish, and realign our minds and bodies. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ against wounds of every kind, self-inflicted wounds, God, because some of us have self-inflicted ourselves. And we pray tonight in the name of Jesus against wounds that have been inflicted externally by the enemy. Let the blood of Jesus Christ locate us tonight. Let it saturate us for complete and supernatural healing now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. God, we pray that you will touch and heal that which is broken within us. Touch and heal that which is bruised. Touch and heal, God, that which the enemy has sought to destroy. May the resurrecting power that spoke for Lazarus speak for us tonight. Every person who is believing you for a miracle, because your word says in John 14:12, if we believe in you, we too shall see your miraculous power manifested through us, and we shall do even greater works than you did while you were here on earth. So Father, we come before the throne tonight and we say, Lord, the needs are many, but no need has escaped you, for you are the omnipresent and omnipotent God, the one who sits high and looks low. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. So tonight we plead the cause of every person who is on this Zoom service, that your eyes will behold them, that your eyes will show them mercy, that your eyes will behold their situation and you will heal them. I stand on the authority you have given me, God, in Luke 10:19, and I receive now the keys to the kingdom of heaven according to Matthew 16:19. I exercise that power, Father God, to tread upon serpents tonight, to tread upon scorpions tonight, to tread upon every power of the enemy, knowing that nothing shall by any means harm me. I exercise my authority tonight to bind and to loose in intercession for the people of God, knowing, Father, that whatever I bind on earth is bound in heaven, and whatever I loose on earth is loose in heaven. We commit the sick and the hurting to you tonight, God. We commit every tear that has been shed. We commit every burden that they are carrying. For you said in your word that if we call upon you, you will answer. So like the woman with the issue of blood, we reach out by faith to you tonight to touch your garment. We ask for healing, just like the woman with the issue of blood. We are trying to reach just the tip, the hem of your garment tonight, because our faith will make us whole. We thank you, God, and we stand on the testimonies that have been shared tonight of your healing power. We stand on the testimonies, God, of Matthew 14:36, that we too can receive healing, God. Sickness is not our portion, because it is through your blood that was shed on Calvary's cross, my God, that we have been set free. And the Bible says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So we decree and declare that our healing is sealed through the blood. According to Isaiah 53:5, you were wounded for our transgressions, you were bruised for our iniquities, and by your stripes we are healed. Through the shedding of your blood on the cross, you have paid for our healing, God. So tonight we receive healing in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We reclaim our health from the enemy. We are redeemed from curses against our health. We bind up every attack against our spiritual, our emotional, our physical health. And we loose the blood over this Zoom service tonight. We saturate ourselves in the blood for full covering tonight. Let the blood arise and speak for those suffering from cancer. Let it arise and speak for those suffering from heart disease. Let the blood arise tonight for those suffering from diabetes. May the blood arise for those suffering from kidney failure. May the blood speak over arthritis. May the blood speak over autoimmune diseases. Every sickness tonight, God Almighty, attacking the people of God, let the blood of Jesus begin to speak over it now. The blood shall speak over every stomach issue. The blood shall speak over fibroids. It shall speak over abnormal bleeding, God. It will speak over intestinal sicknesses tonight. The blood will speak over sickle cell. It must speak over goiter. Every throat issue tonight, we loose the blood. Let the blood speak over high blood pressure, circulation problems. Let the blood speak over flu, respiratory illnesses now. In the name of Jesus, those suffering from mental illnesses. Let the blood locate tonight and begin to move upon them. Emotional disorders, we command you to go in the name of Jesus. Father, every sickness named and those unnamed, we place them before you tonight because you are the great physician, and we decree that by faith we have already been healed. We cancel infirmities, my God, coming through the bloodline. Whatever affected our fathers and forefathers, it stops tonight. It stops with us now. By the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, we decree we are bloodline breakers. It ran in the family until it ran into us. So tonight we step out of agreement with generational sicknesses. We send the fire of God to locate and destroy every altar that has been raised against our health. Let those altars be consumed by the fire of the Holy Spirit. Your word says if two on earth shall touch and agree upon a thing, God, then it shall be done in the name of Jesus. So tonight we decree together and we declare together that we are healed from the top of our head to the soles of our feet tonight. My God, we pray for Sister Chavane's baby. We pray for Amir tonight. Amir is not speaking, God. The speech has been delayed, but you are the same God who put the coals of fire upon the lips of Isaiah. So we decree and declare tonight, coals of fire have been placed upon Amir's lips in the spirit. His speech will come forth. We call the words forth now in the name of Jesus. No more syllables, but full words come out. Sentences come out. Come out. We pull you out in the name of Jesus, and we decree that this child will speak. Every developmental delay, we come against you in the name of Jesus. We curse you like Jesus cursed the fig tree. We command you to dry up and go by the power of the living God. Let your Holy Spirit move upon this child. Let your healing anointing move upon this child. I decree that he will speak. He will speak in the name of Jesus, and he will testify. Mother will testify of the goodness of God, because you are the same God who healed the blind. You are the same God who healed the deaf. You are the God who healed the dumb. There is nothing that shall be impossible with you. So tonight we come into agreement for full healing over this child and every other person who has placed a request right here tonight, God. We touch and agree that it's already done in the mighty name of Jesus. I call you by name, Yamina. I call you by name, Colleen Robinson. I call you by name, Stacy Griffith. I call you by name, Vivian Stone, Rylene Small, every person who has placed a prayer request here tonight, Pastor Maureen Nabanda, may the Spirit of God arise and touch you tonight. Wherever you are, I decree and declare the power of God is coming upon you. You will take up your beds and walk. I said, Talitha Komai, arise tonight and walk. By the power of the living God, we speak to every dead thing in your life. We command them to come alive in the name of Jesus. I speak life right now over your body. Anywhere there's an infirmity, anywhere the enemy is afflicting you, I speak life in the name of Jesus. I decree you will live and not die. You will live and declare the works of the Lord, and no weapon formed against your health will prosper. I decree and declare by the power of the living God that every sickness coming against your children, against your family, is canceled in the name of Jesus. We bind it up and render it powerless against the blood that speaks over you, against the blood that speaks over your children, against the blood that speaks over your family. As of now, we decree and declare by the power of the living God that the healing anointing has been released over this Zoom. It is washing over you. It is washing over you. It is washing over you. Healing is here tonight. Healing is in the atmosphere. Receive it by faith in the name of Jesus. Tonight, Father, we come into agreement, every one of us who is here on this Zoom, that healing is our portion. And already you have done it for us. You have done it for our children. You have done it for our families. It is already done for us because you told us that whatever we ask of you, if we believe that we have received it, then we shall have it. So tonight we receive our healing in the mighty name of Jesus. And we decree and declare that it is done in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. 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 Again, we just want to thank everyone that testified. I would just want to just remind you as we close out, it is impossible to please God without faith. And the very essence of prayer, we have something to do. We have to lift our faith in this season. And we just want to thank every person who prayed and, you know, every person who spoke into our lives just tonight. We just want to thank them right now. As we're about to close, there is a closing song that we want to put on the screen now.
Hopefully,
we might be able to, I'm not sure if we are able to get that just now. We just did the closing prayer. But if we could get a closing song, that would be nice, just to close us out. Again, we just want to thank you for tuning in. There are probably some notices. If we have them, we can put them on this retreat that is coming up, May 17 to 19. The same payment method, the Zelle, the PayPal are the account for persons who want to donate. And of course, if you can't go and you want to bless someone to go, right, and be a blessing to someone, please feel free to do that, because again,